أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، نحمده ونستعين به ونتوكل عليه، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الخلق وخاتم الأنبياء وسيد المرسلين، حبيب إله العالمين، نبينا وحبيب قلوبنا وشفيع ذنوبنا، أبي القاسم محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المطهرين المكرمين. قال الله العظيم في كتابه الكريم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: محمد رسول الله والذين معه أشداء على الكفار رحماء بينهم. آمنا بالله، صدق الله العلي العظيم. Respected elders, sisters and brothers, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. This is a subject of great sensitivity and dispute within the Muslim Ummah for centuries. It is related to a group of people who have indeed included righteous as well as those who are deemed to be bad doers. And their status in the eyes of the school of Ahl al-Bayt has been much scrutinized, misunderstood, and indeed deserves analysis. The Sahaba, the companions of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam, constitute a very significant group of people who have been studied and indeed followed by Muslims for centuries. When you mention the word Sahabi Rasulullah, the thought that comes to your mind is somebody who was with the Holy Prophet, who lived during his time, and indeed interacted and maybe narrated from the Holy Messenger himself. And whilst indeed thousands of the Sahabas are found and their names, perhaps some of them are quite known, some specifically are household names in the Muslim world, especially within Sunni majority Muslim countries. For you find that the Ahlul Sunnah consider the companions of the Holy Prophet as the next best group of people after the Messenger of God. They consider them by and large trustworthy, those who have gained universal adala, so to speak, those who are considered just. And a major source of the Sunnah of the Holy Prophet, the Hadith of the Holy Prophet, in as far as the words and the actions and the approvals of the Messenger of Allah, Muhammad al-Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. So when it comes to this, it's a very key component in studying and analyzing this particular group of people. The notion that whatever they say, whatever they have narrated, is something that should be taken on board and considered one way of understanding the glorious life and the teachings of the Messenger of God in order for people to follow in his footsteps. The definition of a Sahabi, though, has been presented as somewhat a controversial element at the outset when it comes to this discussion, because they would come forward, our brothers from other schools, they come forward and say that the Sahabi, the companion of the Holy Prophet, is somebody who actually met the Holy Prophet even once, or heard from the Holy Prophet whilst the Prophet of Islam was alive. And this is something that, for example, Imam al-Bukhari or Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani in his famous work, Al-Isaba fi Tamiz al-Sahaba, which is probably considered one of the more important sources of literature in discussing the biographies and the legacies and who exactly were the companions of the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him and his family. Yet, when it comes to the school of Ahl al-Bayt, our ulama, they have indeed disagreed with this and have presented a different definition. And they say that the word Sahabi in the Holy Quran doesn't refer to somebody who necessarily is just present or just somehow meet somebody just once. Rather, it's someone who has regular contact. For example, you find in the story of Prophet Yusuf ala nabiyyina wa ala alihi wa alayhi afdal salatu wassalam, the individuals, if you recall, who were there in the prison with Prophet Yusuf, who saw the dream, wanted him to interpret. Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam says, "Ya sahibi sijin, O the ones who are my companions, But as far as the prison is concerned, because they were there with Prophet Yusuf for a considerable period of time, despite the fact that indeed this notion of Sahaba of the Holy Prophet is not used as a term in the Holy Quran, this subject has been a matter of major dissension and disagreement between the various Muslim sects and denominations for centuries. And when it comes to the Ahlus Sunnah themselves, you find that, for example, they would consider, such as the Malikis, the Ash'arites, the Mu'tazilites, they consider the Sahaba as the only way to gain access to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. And then you have some who have extremely gone far in their assessment of the role of the companions, the likes of Ibn Taymiyyah, who has come forward and said that any criticism or non-acceptance of this would constitute as kufr and disbelief. Whereas the school of Ahlul Bayt have clearly come forward and said that when you look at the Holy Quran, as far as Ayatul Tathir, as far as Ayatul Wilaya, as far as Ayatul Dhikr, Ayatul Ikmal, Ayatul Tabligh, Hadithul Thaqalain, Hadithul Ghadir, Hadithul Manzila, Hadith Madinatul Ilm, all these and more point to the Ahlul Bayt alayhum as-salam, the progeny of the Holy Prophet, and indeed their superiority over the rest of the people after the Holy Prophet, and you know, the higher ranking above that of the Sahaba. Yet, considering all this, importantly, the Shia are generally accused of disrespect and disregard, and of course somehow tarnishing the image and the name of the Sahaba of the Holy Prophet. And today perhaps this image exists in the minds of many Muslims, that the Shia don't like the Sahaba, right? That they despise the companions, that they only like a handful of them, that's it. They only like Ammar and Aba Dhar and Salman, for example. Whereas, you know, the rest of the companions, they completely disregard, disrespect, don't know anything about. And this, unfortunately, is used to deter people from the following of the school of Ahlul Bayt, alayhum as-salam, to say, look at these group of individuals. You look at the Sahaba, you've been raised to love the Sahaba, but these group, this sect, they do not regard the followers of the Holy Prophet as far as the Sahaba in good esteem, and therefore they do not respect them, and they should not be somehow learned from. But the school of Ahlul Bayt, the position of our ulama, in as far as the stance on the Sahaba of the Holy Prophet, is quite clear. Let's get this absolutely clear at the discussion at the outset. And that is, we study them on the merit, right? On the merit of their lives. We do not accept the universal integrity of the Sahaba. And the key component is how they lived their lives all throughout until they left this world. Not only a segment of their life that, for example, they were close to the Holy Prophet or they served the religion of Islam, because there are many who deviated. There are many who unfortunately did not stay on the right path. And a key component of this success and this meritorious way of examining and looking at the companions of the Holy Prophet is how they treated the family of the Holy Prophet, the Ahlul Bayt. It is not about just the Shia saying this, it is about the Holy Quran categorically establishing this, قُلْ لَا أَسْأَلُكُمْ عَلَيْهِ أَجْرًا إِلَّا الْمَوَدَّةَ فِي الْقُرْبَى. Similarly, when it comes to the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, would constantly remind those around him, specifically and the other Muslims, about the importance and the sacredness of the family of his. So when it comes to the school of Ahlul Bayt, we look at every companion by their own merit. There is no generalization of companions just because somebody is known as Sahabi, despite even the difference in the definition of who a Sahabi is between the various different theological schools of thought. But having said that, even with that, each Sahabi is studied on their own merit. That's it. And on that note, we have to remember, and people often forget this, that the Quran and the Hadith tells us of the reason why we should do that. Because in Surah Tawbah, for example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمِنْ حَوْلِكُمْ مِنَ الْأَعْرَابِ مُنَافِقُونَ وَمِنْ أَهْلِ الْمَدِينَةِ مَرَدُوا عَلَى النِّفَاقِ. Around you, amongst those who are considered the Bedouins, they are hypocrites. And from the people of Medina, there are those who are stern on hypocrisy. And there are so many other ayat. Yes, in Bukhari and Muslim, we are told of this famous hadith that the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam on the day of Qiyamah would see his sahaba and would say, "Ay Rabbi ashabi, these are my companions, oh my Lord." And then he would get the response, "La tadri ma ahdathu ba'dak." You don't know what they did after you when they're being taken away from Jannah towards Jahannam. And in Sahih Muslim, we find this narration from the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam, who says, "Fi ashabi ithna ashara munafiqan, fihim thamaniya la yadkhuluna al-jannah." Within my companions, there are 12 who are hypocrites. Amongst them, 8 will never enter paradise. And then you have the actions of some of the so-called Sahaba, like Khalid ibn al-Walid, like Talha and Zubayr in the battle of Jamal, like Abdullah ibn Zubayr, Umar ibn al-As. Muawiyah is considered a Sahabi of the Holy Prophet and what he did in Safin, and so on. Yet, that is an introduction that we need to have with regards to where we stand when it comes to Sahaba. But at the same time, what we need to say is the following, and please mark these words and understand. Within the school of Ahl al-Bayt, perhaps we have not studied the lives of the righteous Sahaba who are unknown. Yes, perhaps we have not necessarily looked at them because they're not names that are generally known by people. Those who have unfortunately been tarnished in history because of their stance. Yes, how many of these Sahaba do we actually know? How many of their lives have we actually studied? Yes, you might tell me Jabir ibn Abdullah al-Ansari, Ammar, Salman, Aba Dhar. These are probably household names, but there are so much more. Yes. And indeed, when you look at some works that our ulama have compiled, you have some who have come forward with hundreds of names of Sahaba who indeed stood loyal to Amir al-Mu'mineen, and with various different degrees of attachment, of course, but who, for example, fought alongside him in battles of Jamal, Safin, and Nahrawan. Yes, it can be argued that some fought because of worldly gains and so on, but this is not the only criteria used to come to the conclusion regarding some of the Sahaba of the Holy Prophet that are considered to be quite meritorious and deserve to be understood. Today, we must be able to open up and indeed seek to learn some of their achievements, especially of those Sahaba that are considered to be righteous by all schools of thought, by Sunnis and Shias. My dear sisters and brothers, if you look at, for example, YouTube, or you look at articles and books, one major misconception that's often presented by the enemies of the school of Ahl al-Bayt and those who wish to tarnish reputation and spread false information out there is the fact that we have in our books praise of the Sahaba. Yes. For example, in the words of the Imams alayhim salam, you'll find Amir al-Mu'mineen wa Mawla al-Muttaqeen Ali ibn Abi Talib salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. In the narrations that have been attributed to him, he says, "Laqad ra'aytu ashaba Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam." I was the one who saw the companions of the Holy Prophet, and I don't see anyone today who resembles them. Perhaps he was speaking to a group of people. وَقَدْ بَاتُوا سُجَّدًا وَقِيَامًا. They were spending the night in prostration, standing, right, and sitting and doing sajda. وَيَقِفُونَ عَلَى مِثْلِ الْجَمَرِ مِنْ ذِكْرِ مَعَادِهِمْ. It's like they're standing on hot rock, hot coal, due to the fear that they had of the day of Qiyamah and the remembrance that they had of the day of judgment and Jahannam. Imam Zain al-Abidin al-Sajjad, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, in Sahifatu al-Sajjadiyya, part of a dua he has, he remembers the Sahaba well, and he actually praises the Sahaba. And this has been used against the Shia, right? In this dua number 4, Imam al-Sajjad says, Allahumma wa ashabu Muhammadin khassa. Ya Allah, the ashab, the companions of the Holy Prophet specifically, alladhina ahsanu al-Sahaba, those who were the best and actually achieved well in being companions. وَالَّذِينَ أَبْلَوْا بَلَاءَ الْحَسَنِ فِي النُّصْرَةِ And those who demonstrated qualities of great support in difficult times. فَلَا تَنْسَ لَهُمُ اللَّهُ مَا تَرَكُوا لَكَ وَفِيكَ Oh Allah, you know, let it not be forgotten what they achieved and what they sought to establish. وَارْضِهِمْ مِنْ رِضْوَانِكَ Ya Allah, make you know them of those whom you are pleased with. So, people come forward and say, hold on. صَحِيفَةُ السَّجَّادِيَّ Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen. Other references by the Ahl al-Bayt alayhum as-salam. All point to what? All point to this realization that what? That the companions are being praised within the narrations of the Ahl al-Bayt. So what does this tell you about the stance of the school of Ahl al-Bayt regarding companions? Holy Quran presents an answer regarding this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes forward and says, وَالَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوهُمْ بِإِحْسَانِ Yes, that those who follow with righteousness, yes. And this is a key belief in the school of Ahl al-Bayt. It is known as Muafat. Please mark these words, very important. Muafat is a theological concept. Muafat means that the individual will be judged by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on their state when they died and left this world. So sometimes people may be righteous all along, but then the last 5 minutes of their life, they deviate. It's those last 5 minutes that they will be judged on. You might say this is unfair. No. It is fair indeed. The reason being is that we don't know when we'll die and we have to constantly be on the right path. You look at the example of Hurr ibn Yazid al-Riyahi, right? And on the other scale, you look at, for example, individuals like Bal'ab ibn Ba'ura or others who, for example, worshipped Allah for so many years and then finally towards the end of their life, they deviated. So muafat means that they have to continuously struggle, they have to continuously be on the right path, and they leave this world on this particular state. So when the narrations of the Ahl al-Bayt come and praise the Sahaba, is those Sahaba who stood steadfast, who stood strong, who did not deviate, right? Who stayed on the path of the Ahl al-Bayt, alayhum as-salam. Right. In this particular series, insha'Allah ta'ala, I would like to look at the lives of nine unheard of Sahaba of the Holy Prophet, who were indeed righteous, respected by both Sunnis and Shias. And I underline here the word unheard of, right? By and large, unless somebody has a special interest in the lives of the Sahaba, or perhaps we've heard of them being referenced here and there, but perhaps there isn't a detailed examination of their lives. And importantly, what kind of lessons we can learn and apply into our own lives. This is the beginning tonight, inshallah, the eve of the great month of Rahmah, great month of forgiveness, great month of the Holy Quran. And it is indeed within our obligatory and recommended instructions for us to be able to improve and advance in our lives. And one area of advancement is to indeed learn from those that came before us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us in the Holy Quran examples. The hadith as well as Islamic history gives us numerous examples of people whom we should look at and indeed learn from. And I would like to discuss these nine individuals in order for us to at least be introduced to them, at least for us to say to people, you know what, I know about some of the Sahaba of the Holy Prophet, some who stood strong, some who perhaps all my life I was necessarily not aware of their names and their achievements and their indeed legacy. And tonight, I would like to look at the first individual, and that as an example of somebody who is righteous and we respect and revere, who is a Sahabi of the Holy Prophet, who is necessarily unknown by many, many, many people, especially within the school of Ahl al-Bayt, and perhaps even indeed in the Muslim world. And that individual, his name is Khuzaymah ibn Thabit. Now, who is Khuzaymah? Khuzaymah is a man known as Dhu-Shahadatayn, the man with the two witnesses, the two testimonies. And he came from the tribe of Al-Aws in Yathrib, in Madinat al-Munawwara. And therefore, he was known from the Ansar. He was a man who fought alongside the Holy Prophet in all his battles, except the Battle of Badr. And he was actually among those who destroyed the idols of his community when he embraced Islam. He was amongst those who wanted to rid this particular area from these statues. One incident, though, in his life defined who he was, and indeed made him amongst those beloved by the Holy Prophet and praised indeed. And this is an important incident that gave him the name, the title, Dhu-Shahadatain, the one who had two shahadas, two witnesses, two testimonies. The story is as follows. The Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam bought a horse from a Bedouin, and the horse was later known as Murtajiz. When he had bought this horse, a bit later, influenced by some munafiqeen, that Bedouin was told that, look, you know what, the Prophet paid you was not much. You can get much more for this. So go and try and take more money by creating a story that the Prophet necessarily was, and this is not how much they have agreed. Because, you know, when something is sold, the money is given, and then they take it. They don't necessarily count the bag of money that was there at that time. Perhaps they kind of trust, and then they come back if there is a problem. So this individual came back to the Holy Prophet and said to the Holy Prophet that this is not how much we agreed. What you gave me is not how much we agreed as far as the horse is concerned. You have to give me more. The Holy Prophet looked at him and says, وَالَّذِي بَعَثَنِي بِالْحَقِّ لَقَدْ بِعْتَنِي بِهَذَا. By the Lord who sent me with the truth, this is exactly how much we agreed. This is what I agreed to sell you. You sold me the horse, and this is how much I gave you, and that's it. The Arabi said, okay, bring someone to witness that I sold you the horse at this price. Where is your witness? At that moment, Khuzaymah was there. Khuzaymah ibn Thabit, a Sahabi of the Holy Prophet, one of the Ansar, was there. He raised his hands and he said, أَنَا أَشْهَدُ أَنَّكَ قَدْ بَايَعْتَهُ. I bear witness that this was sold in accordance with what the Prophet of Islam had said. Ajib. But Khuzaymah was not there. You know, when the transaction had taken place between the Prophet and the Bedouin, Khuzaymah was not there. But Khuzaymah is now saying, I am somebody who testifies. The Holy Prophet of Islam knows, but he asks so the people could know. He would say to him, بِمَ تَشْهَدْ وَلَمْ تَحْضَرْهُ وَتَعْلَمَهُ. How is it that you're testifying and you weren't even there and you didn't even know? Look at the answer of Khuzaymah. Allahu Akbar. These are individuals we look up to, brothers and sisters. These are individuals that are our role models. Yes, Khuzaymah says, Ya Rasulullah, نحن نصدقك على وحي من السماء فكيف لا نصدقك على هذه القضية على تلك القضية. O Prophet of Islam, we have testified and believed you when it comes to the revelations from the heavens. When it comes to a matter like this, how can we not believe you? It makes sense, right? It makes sense, you know, logically. But you know, these are people who, you know, establish their mark, right? And then thereafter, those around him and the other Sahaba, you know, really admired his stance. Really admired that logic that he came forward with. And therefore, he was known as Dhu-Shahadatain. Now, this Shahadatain refers to either the one who gave two witnesses, or, you know, the one who's equal to two men witnessing. Two men or two individuals giving a witness. And the Prophet of Islam sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam approved his shahada, said, yes, I accept your testimony. People celebrated, and it was a wonderful occasion. And you know, in this, there are lessons, my dear sisters and brothers. The first is, not everything that we cannot see, we cannot or should not believe in. You know, this belief in the unseen is a key characteristic of the mu'mineen, of the muttaqeen, الذين يؤمنون بالغيب. We must have iman and we must have yaqeen. This yaqeen must be something that is applied into our lives. Unfortunately, today, when it comes to certain matters that I may not understand, certain issues in sharia that are not easy to digest, we have people who simply reject them because it doesn't make sense to them. But when it comes to Islam and Islamic teachings, you hear people coming forward and saying everything makes sense. But in reality, when it comes to our aqa'id, our beliefs, yes. But when it comes to our fiqh, the prayers of the morning being 2 and the prayers of Maghrib being 3 may not necessarily make sense. In the idea of, okay, why khums is 20%? Why is it a fifth of prophets? Why is it not less? Why is it not more? For example, why do we go around the Kaaba 7 times, not 8, not 6, not 10, right? This idea of everything is rational, everything makes sense, and everything can be explained, unfortunately, is short-sighted. It's not necessarily accurate. There is that element of the importance of the belief in the unseen, and that has to be indeed something that we keep into our consideration. This submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are going through a crisis of submission in our communities and our society, especially amongst the youth. I call it with conviction a crisis. Why crisis? Because every individual, Tom, Dick or Ali, comes forward and says what? And says, you know what? I don't like this. This hijab, this thing, I'll define this. This ulama, I've got it wrong. This is what is right. This is what should be happening. And of course, there are those who are weak-hearted. They say, okay, yes, bismillah. Whereas you look at the people of like Khuzaymah, yes, Rasulullah has come forward and brought it, I will accept it. As a believer, as a Muslim, I know that Allah wants the best for me. And I know there are experts, ulama, who have come and worked and studied and, you know, placed so much effort for so many years. And they have come up with a ruling. At the end of the day, yes, if I want to be like them, brilliant. And I can come up with my own ruling. But if I'm not like them, I'm not here to make up fiqh and apply it into my own life because I feel it makes sense. So, this incident led to his tribe, the Aus, to feel great sense of pride. And they kept saying, you know, from us is Ghasilul Malaika. You know, Hamdala ibn Rahab, the one who got married, and in the morning, he went to fight. He didn't do ghusl after he got married, and then he was martyred. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, informs the Holy Prophet that the malaika are washing his body. Yes, and they kept saying, "Waminna dushahadatayn Khuzaima." These are whom? These are the tribe feeling a sense of, you know, great achievement that amongst them is this man by the name of Khuzaima dushahadatayn. And the Khazraj, you know, there's always Aus and Khazraj, and the Khazraj tribe, when they heard that the Aus are boasting about their people, they came forward and said, but amongst us are those who gather the Holy Quran, Zayd ibn Thabit, Abu Zayd, Ubay ibn Ka'ab, Ma'ad ibn Jabal. We also have great individuals. And this caused a bit of tension amongst the two tribes. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed chapter 3, verse 102 to 103. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu attaqullaha haqqa tuqatih wa la tamutunna illa wa antum muslimun wa'tasimu bihablillahi jami'an wa la tafarraqu. The famous verse regarding unity or coming together and not being divided. A key component though of the life of Khuzaima is the fact that he is amongst those who stood by the commander of the faithful, Amir al-Mu'mineen, Ali ibn Abi Talib, peace and blessings be upon him, after the sad demise of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. And of course, he was one of the 12 who stood up to the first Khalifa Abu Bakr in Masjid al-Nabawi, you know, after the right of Amir al-Mu'mineen was taken away. He stood up and said, أيها الناس ألستم تعلمون أن رسول الله قبل شهادتي ولم يرد معي غيري. Ya, O people, don't you know that the Holy Prophet accepted my shahada, my testimony? Right? فأشهد إني سمعت رسول الله يقول. I bear witness, I heard the Messenger of Allah say, أهل بيتي يفرقون بين الحق والباطل. It is my family who differentiate, who will make the difference between the حق and the باطل. الله أكبر. وهم الأئمة الذين الذي يقتدى بهم. They are the imams that must be followed. This is Khuzaima saying. This is the man ذو الشهادتين. All Muslims, Sunni and Shia, respect him and revere him. Yes? And he comes forward and says, I bear witness, it is the أهل البيت whom must be listened to, and it is the أهل البيت whom must be indeed followed. But unfortunately, they did not listen to him. Unfortunately, they did not take what he said. He was amongst the first to give bay'ah to Imam Ali alayhi salam and fought alongside him in the battle of Jamal. And in Siffin, he was a warrior, reminding people what the Holy Prophet of Islam would say. He would say, لَقَدْ سَمِعْتُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ يَقُولْ عَمَّارْ تَقْتُلُهُ الْفِئَةُ الْبَاغِيَةُ. Ammar will be killed by the treacherous individuals who have strayed from religion. Yes? And when Ammar was martyred, yes, he kept repeating this. Lest people remember that, look, you know, it is not about, you know, just Ali ibn Abi Talib, in the idea that he is, the haqq is following Ali ibn Abi Talib, isn't it? And when Ammar was martyred, he entered his tent. He did ghusl, he washed his body, and he went to fight. And then he attained shahada and became one of the shuhada of wilaya of Amir al-Mu'mineen. And he attained shahada in the battle of Safin. Yes, Khuzaima ibn Thabit dhu shahadatain. Peace and blessings be upon him, an individual who indeed stayed loyal to the path of Amir al-Mu'mineen. That's why Amir al-Mu'mineen would mourn him and say, أَيْنَ إِخْوَانِي الَّذِينَ رَكَبُوا الطَّرِيقَ وَمَضُوا عَلَى الْحَقِّ. Where are my brothers who took the path of righteousness? Yes. أَيْنَ عَمَّارُ وَأَيْنَ إِبْنُ التَّهْيَانُ وَأَيْنَ ذُو الشَّهَادَتَيْنِ. Where is Ammar? Where is Ibn Tahyan? Where is ذُو الشَّهَادَتَيْنِ? The one with the two witnesses. My dear sisters and brothers, despite being a Sahabi and despite being one of the narrators of Hadith, yes, one moment and one action, yes, defined whom this man Khuzaima ibn Thabit was. Dhu shahadatain, stood up and gave support to Rasulullah. And of course, this continued afterwards towards Amir al-Mu'mineen. Peace and blessings be upon him. And remember, we have to ask ourselves, what defines our lives? Sometimes one action of ours, sometimes one stance we make, sometimes one decision we make, indeed is defining for all our lives. We must never take anything like this for granted. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us and give us tawfiq to follow in the footsteps of the righteous Sahaba of the Holy Prophet, and of course before them, the Ahlul Bayt. Peace and blessings be upon them. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلي اللهم على محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين.